to everyone he meets, he stays a stranger. With every move he makes, another chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man. They've given you a number and taken away your name.
This podcast is a member of the Place to Be Nation family. Visit us at placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, it's time to grab your popcorn and your drink. Please take your seat and always silence your cell phones. The next showing of Place to Be Nation's Laughing Theater with Andy Atherton is about to begin.
Place to Be Nation, welcome back to the theater, the Laughing Theater. That's right, it's another great episode of Place to Be Nation. Boops! Laughing Theater. I am Andy Atherton. I am your host, and I have a great guest tonight, and we're going to watch a great movie, one of my favorite comedies of all time, featuring one of my favorite comedic actors as well. I'm very glad that my guest picked that, but you know what? Who is my guest? Let's find out right now. He's a very popular guy here on Place of Nation. Bop! He is a co-host on Hard Traveling Fanboys. Also, over on the Place of Nation wrestling feed, he is a co-host on Talking WCW and the What If podcast. Mr. Greg Phillips. Greg, thank you for joining me tonight.
Andy Atherton, thank you so much, sir, for having me on. I have listened to the Laughing Theater just recently with Jennifer Smith, and it's a laugh riot. I highly recommend people check that out. I'm just honored to be asked on. You're one of the best people we have here at Place to Be Nation, as far as I'm concerned.
Oh, right back at you, Greg. Thank you so much. It means a lot coming from you. You are quite often on a lot of shows here. You're a great host, a great guest. I know it's a love fest all around.
Hey, I'm all about love fest.
All right. But since this is Laughing Theater, I like to get to know my guests a little bit more. I know Greg has been on Great Debate. He's been on Looking Forward, Looking Back. Maybe we'll get on Year in Pop when we get a little further ahead. Once we get the old school crew, give them a break for a little while. But, you know, let's talk about Hard Traveling Fanboys. Now, that is one of my favorite shows. I am not a comic book guy at all. Just because I just never really got into it. Although, the other day, I'm unpacking. I recently moved about a month ago, and I'm going through a bin, and I had all these magazines and stuff I saved, like Sports Illustrated and, Entertainment Weeklies. And I came across my small comic book collection of Transformers and G.I. Joe comics. And I also found I own The Death of Superman.
I believe, actually, Andy, that every American owns that comic book.
Yeah.
Whether they realize it or not.
Yeah, see.
Whether they were a kid at the time, or they had a kid at the time, or had a grandkid at the time, everybody in America has a copy of that somewhere in their house.
Yeah, I guess I probably bought it because it was such a big deal at the time, I guess, that I figured, hey, why not? But anyway, so yeah,
there are two comic books that are like that, that are sort of like ubiquitous, and the Death of Superman.
Okay.
And the other one is the 1991 X-Men relaunch, X-Men number one by Jim Lee, which has this incredible millions and millions of copies sold around the world. And people just – you'll just find them sitting around now for 50 cents in a comic book store. But at the time, all of the kids that were into comics – wanted to have like three or four different copies of it because it had this long wraparound cover. So that one and then Death of Superman are these two sort of like cornerstones of comic book collecting from that era.
Yeah. Awesome. Yeah. My son actually has some. We go to the Dave and Buster's, and sometimes he'll take his tickets and he'll cash it in, and he'll get I don't think they're worth anything. It's like usually like an enclosed plastic wrapped like four or five books in there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So he likes to read them. I have not really looked close attention to see what actually is in there, but you know, he seems to like them. And we're into the comic book movies, you know, the MCU,
oh sure,
the DCU. I mean, speaking of the MCU though, you and Nick, Duke, your partner over there on Hard Charlie Fanboys, you guys just completed a great audience participation filled kind of a giant size HTF where you guys ranked the MCU movies from 22 down to 1. It was a great listen. You know, got me through a couple of my commutes this week. So I want to thank you for that. A lot of laughs, a lot of fun. And you guys, you know, you had some bonus categories in there, which I really enjoyed hearing everybody's choices. So tell us about HTF, because I one of the reasons why I love the show is because getting to know you guys a little bit. The fact that you guys are such close friends and have been for so long, that comes through. That camaraderie, and not just your incredible knowledge of comics and all that jazz, but it's just you could just feel it, I guess, the way it's when you're listening to it, just the banter, I guess, from you guys. So how did HTF, that is the, let me see if I can get this right, the longest running weekly episodic comic book podcast in all of Place to Be Nation?
You got it on one try.
Wow. Awesome. And that's up at Hololoon Plaza in Vancouver, British Columbia. Is that correct?
That is correct. Every week we travel from our backwoods Alabama hometowns all the way to Vancouver to the Hololoon Plaza inside the L-shaped studio where we record our show just for the pleasure of our listeners and primarily ourselves.
So how did HTF get started?
Well, first of all, I want to say thank you for the very kind words about our show. You know, that's really nice of you to say. It got started. Nick and I have known each other since 2006. So I had actually just graduated from college, and Nick was a freshman in college. But I came back to take more classes and to be the editor of our school newspaper. Nick was a freshman coming in to work on the school newspaper. That's kind of how we met. We both happened to be wrestling fans, which kind of caused us to be friends because there weren't a whole lot of wrestling fans at Troy University in 2006. So from there, you know, a brotherhood was born, and we became a thicker than thieves pretty much after that, watching all these wrestling shows together over the years. We've been to, I think, 4 or 5 WrestleManias at this point together. And about 2013, well, I should preface this, but we also were big fans of comic books. Mm-hmm. And that united us even further in addition to the wrestling stuff, where we – though wrestling's kind of our first love – comics came right in there with it. And so we bonded over that over the course of time. And about 2013, Place to Be Nation was launching, and our good buddy Todd Weber sent us a message asking if we would be interested in doing a comic book column for their website, placetobenation.com. Talked to Nick about it, and you know, I think he had first invited us individually, and I said, why don't we do it together? It'd be easier on us. We were both working as newspaper reporters at the time, which, as you might imagine, can take up a lot of time.
Mm-hmm.
So I figured, you know, I could work on a little bit when I was at work. He could work on a little bit when he was at work. So we started this column that was I think we tried to do a weekly column at the time. And it didn't really work out that well. We put it out when we could. We had a lot of delays because it was just time consuming. But we did it for about maybe 2 years, and I think it was really good. We had a good thing going, but we just could not keep up a consistent schedule. And then the podcasting network kind of took off. Place to Be Nation Pop launched and became a thing, and they wanted us to do a Hard Traveling Fanboys podcast. We said, we'll give it a shot because we thought it would be less time consuming. It is. And we thought it would just be easier to do. So we started, and we have not missed a week. We have hit every single week for, I think we're on like 160 something episodes now.
Oh, so, God, that's amazing.
Yeah, we've not missed a week. So I'm pretty proud of that. And you're right. I hope it comes through to the audience, but Nick and I are so close. We talk every day over our lunch breaks on the phone just about, you know, random crap. And so our philosophy to the show is we want it to sound like our phone conversations, mm-hmm. like just two friends talking to each other, making fun of each other, razzing each other about all of these pop culture unimportant things that we're into. So that's our goal, and hopefully we get pull it off most of the time.
Yeah, yeah, you guys do. I totally relate because, you know, you hear Scott and Justin, you know, they work together and they found out they're wrestling fans. One of my best friends to this day, you know, my friend Steve, we became friends sophomore year of high school. And, you know, and part of it was wrestling. You know, we went to like 5 or 6 pay-per-views together. He, you know, we both grew up, you know, got married. I got divorced. He got, you know, he moved to actually Alabama. He's up in Northern Alabama for a job. Yeah. He's actually coming for a visit, in a few weeks, which is awesome. But yeah, I totally understand that part of it. And also I did the newspaper in college as well. I did movie reviews for the Ionian at Iona College. Cool. So yeah, so I highly suggest you all listen to HTF. You guys kind of switch it up because you have traditional episodes. I mean, I know Hard Travelers for Hire just ended because of the MCU kind of like, you know, hitting a point, I guess, so to speak.
We don't, a dividing line.
Yeah,
we're actually working right now behind the scenes to try to come up with a replacement series for that, and we're still batting around some ideas on that.
Well, I'm sure whatever it is, it's going to be a lot of fun. And also, you have a presence on our other feed, the wrestling feed.
Yes.
So we'll stay with your partner, Mr. Duke, and you guys. This is more your most recent show, actually, to launch, called What If. Now, I've listened to a couple of the episodes, and I quite enjoy them. Why don't you tell everybody what If is about?
What If Wrestling is actually kind of tied into comic books, believe it or not. The idea for this came about because of the classic Marvel comic series What If, which was a comic book series that ran for several decades that basically posed the question, what if a classic comic book storyline turned out differently? So you would have the story, and it was kind of like a one-off story where a writer would get to explore what would have happened if, for instance, if Captain America ended up with Thor's hammer instead of Thor, or what if, you know, what if a different character had become Iron Man instead of Tony Stark? Mm-hmm. So it's stuff like that. And so we thought, what if we could apply that to wrestling, taking classic moments, matches, storylines, things of that nature in wrestling history and altering them, just taking a switching out a key figure, one key choice that was made creatively and changing that around and seeing how it affects things. And we knew that we didn't want to – because we're on the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed is a cornucopia of people who know a whole lot more about wrestling than myself and Nick Duke, people that have watched a lot more wrestling. So we wanted to be different. We knew we didn't want to talk for 2 or 3 hours about this stuff because we'd run out of things to say. And what we decided to do was to get into a pod blast format, which we consider to be podcasts of about 25 minutes or less. And what we've done is kind of stumbled upon a little bit of a formula where we'll take a topic in wrestling history. I'm trying to think of something that we did like
Punk.
Yeah. What if CM Punk had not quit the WWE in January 2014? How would that have affected the next several months and even year of storylines? And kind of bat that back and forth with our different theories and ideas of what it might have looked like, what the landscape might have looked like if that had happened. And so actually, it's a good chance to tell the listeners now, if you guys have any ideas, if you're a wrestling fan and you have some ideas, we actually do have a list that we're keeping right now. But if you want to shoot that our way, send it to gbphillips at troy.edu, which is my kind of shoot email address. You can send it to Greg P at placetobenation.com. Or you can send it to gphillips8652 at twitter.com.
Wow.
Because we are trying to gather some ideas here. And because they're so short, we can record them in bursts. So we can get like 3 episodes recorded at a time and kind of get those in the can. So we've got a few of those recording sessions coming up. But that's kind of how that whole thing came about. Hopefully people will dig it.
Well, it's awesome. That's actually, as a wrestling fan, that is something that people – wrestling fans talk about all the time. What if this didn't happen? What if that didn't happen? Like one I could think of right now, maybe what if Shawn Michaels was able to jump during the Monday Night Wars?
Yeah.
Because he was being such a prick backstage, and he wanted to be in the NWO so bad that eventually, once, you know, Vince bought WCW and he brought, you know, the Outsiders and Hogan in, you knew Shawn was going to put that friggin' white and yellow, white and black shirt on at some point.
Yeah.
You know,
and the weird French beret that he was wearing for a while.
Yes, that's awesome. And also, What If actually is the comic version is becoming a TV series.
Yes, for the Disney Plus streaming app.
So I'm very excited for that. And then your other show on the wrestling feed is Talking WCW, and that is with Jennifer Smith and Tim Capel of Talking Pop fame. So why don't you talk about that for a moment and let the listeners know what that's about.
Talking WCW is essentially our love letter to World Championship Wrestling, an organization that means a lot to me because I did grow up in the Deep South. And down here, I'm much like how I'm assuming in the Northeast, the World Wrestling Federation was the king. Well, down here in the South, WCW was the king. And so a lot of us down here grew up watching World Championship Wrestling and really loving it. And I think one of the ideas behind this show, which I owe all the credit to Tim and Jenny, they came to me with this idea. I was happy to jump on with them. Because I feel like WCW over the years has kind of gotten raked over the coals, sometimes deservedly so, sometimes not deservedly so. And what I wanted this show to be was kind of a chance to remind people that at its best, WCW was really, really good. And there were some really good wrestlers that worked for that company. And so what we've decided to do is an approach that Tim and Jenny helped develop, which is the idea of taking three individual matches of a performer or of a concept and focusing on those three individual matches. And so each of us picks a match and we bring our match to the show and the other two individuals watch it as well. And when we hit the show, we kind of talk honestly and openly about our thoughts on the match, you know, the emotions we had during the match, the good things in the match, the bad things in the match, you know, what our impressions were of the performer that we're spotlighting at a given time. And I think it's a unique format and a cool format from three people with three different perspectives on WCW. You know, I kind of watched the whole evolution of WCW. Tim came in and started watching WCW a little later and has kind of discovered his love of the older stuff in recent years. And Jenny is a pretty recent fan of wrestling. She's only been watching wrestling for maybe a year, 2 years. And so it's three different perspectives. Tim and I are both longtime fans, but we each have different perspectives as well. And, you know, we've spotlighted wrestlers like Ric Flair and Dusty Rhodes and just recently Dustin Rhodes. And this next episode that we're doing is actually going to be our first one that is not about a wrestler. We're going to be doing the War Games concept.
Ooh.
And each of us will pick a different War Games match to discuss. So honestly, when we first started this podcast, I was a little nervous because I do a weekly show and I don't have a lot of time on my hands. But I'm telling you, man, it is so fun. It is just a blast to do this show. Tim and Jenny make it so much fun for me, and I'm just happy to be along for the ride, honestly.
Awesome, awesome. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I mean, I do love WCW, too. I am a Northerner. I'm a Yankee, so to speak. But I grew up. You know, I was watching it at 6:05 on the Superstation. I was watching WCW Saturday Night. I always tuned in or recorded Nitro or Raw, whatever, whichever one I decided that week. You know, and I actually went to one WCW show. They came up to the Meadowlands Arena, the Brendan Byrne, I guess, would you call it? I don't remember what year it was, but actually, I had one of my coolest wrestling fan experiences was we got there early, and some of the wrestlers were just walking in. You know, just. You know, walk in there and there's Hawk and Animal and Abdullah the Butcher just walking in.
Oh, man.
I was like, yeah. And everybody's like, yo, Hawk, do it. Hawk, do it. Of course, he's like, yeah, what a rush. I mean, Animal's legs were like as big as my entire body. I remember. And then we saw a car come in. It was a rental car. And it was Jim Cornette, the Midnight Express. I want to say it was Stan and Bobby and Mark Calloway sitting in the back seat. Pre-Undertaker.
Wow.
And then we saw a limo come in. We assumed that was Ric Flair's. it was a fun show. My buddy Steve, who I mentioned earlier, totally geeked out because he got Lance Russell's autographed. So you could tell what kind of fan he is.
Right, right.
Yeah. So, and then it was a fun show. There was a well-endowed lady in the front row, and she was up and jaw-jacking all night with wrestlers. I mean, at one point she got up to leave. I guess she went to the ladies' room or something. The whole place went boo. And when she came back in, a big pop, like a run-in pop kind of happened. And then, you know, main event was Flair. I don't remember who he was wrestling. I don't know. Sting, maybe? I don't know. And he got jaw-jacking with her. And it was so much fun. I'm sure, you know, she got a backstage pass that night.
I was going to say, she probably rode Space Mountain that night.
Yeah.
But, yeah. But, you know, yeah, I loved – and I love the WWF too. Like, my – even though I loved WCW, my favorite wrestler when I was a kid was Bret Hart.
Mm-hmm.
And I never got – WWF never came down where we were in Florida to do shows. And so – I never got to see Bret Hart in his prime. I did not get to see the Hitman perform until Uncensored 98, the pay-per-view that they held in my hometown of Mobile, Alabama. It was the first time I got to see. And so it was kind of – that would always be a regret of mine that I only got to see WCW Bret Hart. I never got to see the real Hitman in action. So that's a lifelong regret. But I love both companies. But I just feel like kind of over the years that – the WCW's gotten a little bit of a bad rap, and it deserves a lot of it, but, you know, it wasn't all bad.
No, it's great. We needed a WCW show, and you guys have filled that hole quite nicely. I'm actually going to be dipping my toes on the wrestling feed. I'm not going to be like a regular show. It's going to be like a quarterly show, so I'm still hammering out the things, but, you know, it's going to be kind of a biography type show. So,
cool.
Yeah, so it should be fun. Hopefully,
so you'll be hanging and banging on the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed.
Yes, I will. I will. I do appear on Main Event from time to time when I bring Great Debate over there to, you know, kind of put, you know, Scott and Nate and Steve on their toes with some of my questions and my quickfire. So, yeah, I like going over there. I just, you know, this is my wheelhouse. So, I mean, I've been a lifelong wrestling fan, but I have a crap memory. So I've watched so much wrestling over the years, I couldn't tell you anything. Like, when I hear, like, Chad and Scott and Justin, like, start spewing off things, and I'm like, I know I watched that show, but I have no fucking clue what they're talking about. You know, I was happy to get my participation trophy in a trivia tournament. That's all I wanted to do. So, but, all right, so we all got to know Greg and all about his show. So, Greg, why don't you tell everybody, what are we watching tonight here on the Laughing Theater?
We are watching tonight what I consider to be one of the greatest comedies of all time, one of my favorite movies of all time. We are watching Austin Powers, International Man of Mystery.
Awesome, yes. The 1997 comedy, the first of the Austin Powers movies. And, yes, I love this movie. And I was very happy when you selected this as your inaugural Laughing Theater appearance title. You know, I was a huge Mike Myers fan, you know, when he was on Saturday Night Live, and then he did Wayne's World and So I Married an Axe Murderer, and then this just, you know, blew my doors off when this came out. How come you picked it, though? We know it's like one of your favorites, one of your greatest, but what about this movie did you want to watch it tonight about? Why?
Well, Austin Powers, the series really, was such a big part of my teenage years. Mm-hmm. This came out when I was 13.
Oof, make me feel old.
And so you got to understand, when you're a kid and, you know, honestly, the first several times I saw this movie, I didn't even get a lot of the jokes.
Yeah,
I got a lot of them, but I didn't get nearly all of them. So it's like there's like stuff in here that I had no idea was what it was until years later. But it was just cool. It felt cool. It felt different. And it was my style of humor. It's this sort of absurdist, self-referential kind of humor that is kind of winking at the audience a little bit, but it gets into some, you know, some crudeness and some sex jokes, things like that, but it doesn't get to me vulgar. It doesn't get, you know, it doesn't rely on that for the joke. The joke is kind of the silliness of the whole mm-hmm. thing. And so, I've just always adored this movie and this series, but this one in particular, I wanted us to start from the beginning. Even though the sequel is actually my favorite in the series, mm-hmm. I wanted us to hit the first one, because this is one of the most quotable movies of all time. I still to this day, and my friends will attest to this, I will beat the jokes from these movies into the ground.
Mm-hmm.
So to this day, especially from this one, there are so many scenes from this that I'll quote, lines that I'll quote. You know, we'll talk about a sequence later at the casino that is just – one of my favorite things in a movie ever. So I thought it was just the safe pick for me, honestly, to go to. It was either this, it was this, or Coming to America, and I settled on this.
Well, Coming to America is a great movie, but yeah, I actually dressed up as Austin Powers for Halloween one year.
Oh man!
And yeah, my I was so I don't know if I might have been married to my ex-wife at the time, but it was after the second one had come out. And we went to the store, and I'm like, look, she's always like, oh, let's do a couple of costumes. I'm like, all right, I want to be Austin Powers. So we looked at the Felicity Shagwell costume, and she like was like, nope, this is way too short. So she found a one-piece like go-go dress with a British flag. So she wore that, and we kind of like did that together. And we went to a bar that night, and I was in the contest, and I lost to the mystery woman. So it was a girl with a mask with cleavage out to you, God, everywhere, and you could tell who was picking the choices that night.
You really didn't have much of a chance in that situation.
When they announced the winner and it was her, all my friends, because actually it was one of my fraternity brothers' bands was playing that night at the bar, all my friends just started chanting Austin Powers. I was like, Austin Powers, Austin. And of course, the drunk morons that voted for her never gave me my $25 prize, whatever the fuck it was. But
they owe you. I think you need to. I think right now, if they're listening to this podcast, they owe you that $25.
Yes. I'll drive down to White Plains, New York, to see if the bar is even still around. Awesome. So you were about 13 when this came out. So did you see this in the theater, or was this a home rental video?
This was a home rental. So my parents and I used to have movie night every Friday. So we would we'd go to the Blockbuster and rent a VHS and watch it every Friday night from the time that I was probably about 5 years old up till I was probably 18 years old. And so this was a VHS rental. We knew nothing about it. We just knew that Mike Myers was in it, and we were fans of Mike Myers. I honestly didn't know what to make of it. My dad didn't know what to make of it. My mom was the one that really wanted to see it because she loves Mike Myers. And so we sat down and watched this, and we just fell in love with this movie pretty much instantly. And it became one of those that you just watch over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. And then we watched both of the next two movies in the theaters. We saw Spy Who Shagged Me, I think, twice in the theater, and we saw Goldmember once in the theater. So it sort of became a weird family bonding experience.
Yeah, I don't know if my son's seen it. He's 13 now. My daughter's 17. I let her watch this a few years ago, and her mom did actually yell at me. I'm like, it's Austin Powers. Are you kidding me?
It's harmless. It's harmless fun.
I'm like, she's not going to understand the jokes anyway, half of them. She's just going to think it's funny because he's silly.
Yeah.
Which is true, you know.
And he's got the great British accent. Yeah. You know. So much to love.
Yeah. So we're going to get started with the movie in a minute. I've heard talk recently that Mike Myers may be actually penning a fourth Austin Powers movie. Now, what do you think? Do you think the franchise could return and be a success?
That rumor's been seems to float around every couple years. Yeah. Like, it feels like for the last 15 years we've been hearing every couple years, well, he's working on Austin Powers 4. Well, he's working on Austin Powers 4. I'm of two minds about it, because on the one hand, there really isn't a good track record of sequels that wait this long to come out that are actually good, right? So, you know, it's very rare that a movie would – I mean, Goldmember was like 2003, I think.
Yeah.
So we'd be going – you know, if he wrote it and it got filmed and it hit theaters in 2021, that would be 18 years, I think, between movies. That's a bit of a long stretch. So it probably won't work. However, here's the caveat to that. I would be the first person in line to see it if it happened. What I would like, I would love for him to do an Austin Powers 4 and to get Dana Carvey involved.
Oh, yeah. I love Dana Carvey.
Yeah, I think it would be a cool, like, Wayne's World reunion of sorts, and then get him involved in a series that he really should have been in at some point. So I would like to see it. I do. If they do have, if it does happen, I want them to pretty much ignore the events of Goldmember at the end.
Yes,
and just go back to Dr. Evil as the bad guy, and you know.
Yeah, he became too hip and cool, and you know, and Fat Bastard wasn't fat anymore. So just it kind of kind of went off the rails, so to speak.
Right.
Awesome. So we're gonna start 1 minute, but first, we're going to pause for a second and just talk about what's going on here at Place to Be Nation. I am not sure when this is dropping, but there is a brand new show called DC4U. That is the manager, Todd Weber, and Mr. Russell Sellers is the only dedicated DC show on the Place of the Nation pop feed. So the first episode, the guys kicked off by celebrating the anniversaries of Batman and Batman 89. And your HTF partner, Nick Duke, is the first guest.
Yes. Yes, Nick is in the rare position of being a guest on a show. Mm-hmm. And so I'm curious. I haven't listened to it yet, but I'm curious to check that one out and to see how my cohort did.
Yeah, yeah. He's also actually going to be on The Great Debate on the next episode. I can tell you that much. You are an alumnus of The Great Debate.
I am. That should be an interesting listen as well. Yeah. Nick, for once, being put into a position of guesting somewhere else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, get him out of his comfort zone there, hopefully. Mm-hmm. He'll do great. You guys, you know, you just had Avengers Month with your giant size edition we talked about earlier. And then what's coming up over there on HTF? We got X-Men, since Dark Phoenix is the next comic movie?
We're actually knee-deep in X-Men Month. Mm-hmm. We have... by the time you've heard this, you probably will have heard our first entry in X-Men Month, which is a countdown of where we're basically what we just did for the MCU, where we ranked all the movies. We did that for the X-Men movies.
We
took every Fox X-Men movie along with both Deadpools, both Wolverine movies, all three Wolverine mm-hmm. movies, and we ranked all of them from 1 to 11. And that should be out now, and I think that's going to be a really good listen for people. There's some real, as my good buddy Tim would say, turd busters on that list.
Yeah.
And then there's also some amazing all-time classics on that list.
Like X-Men The Last Stand is a turd buster.
Yes, absolutely. And X2 would be an all-time classic.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, it's amazing how Brett Ratner shit on that franchise.
Oh, God, so bad. And then there's Logan, which I would put up there with any comic book movie that's ever been made. So just great stuff there. And then we've got a review of Dark Phoenix coming up here in the coming weeks. And we've got a review of X-Men The Last Stand. We're going to revisit that and see which one got the Dark Phoenix story right, if either of them.
Both written by Simon Kinberg.
No yes. Less. And then we're going to wrap things up with a long Book Hunters episode where we review a book called X-Men Grand Design. So look out for that here on PTBN Pop.
Awesome, awesome. So is July going to be Spider-Man month with Spider-Man Far From Home coming out?
I believe that is the plan. We've been saved by theme months for quite some time now. August is going to be our first non-theme month in a while, so it's going to be interesting to see what happens there. But yeah, July is going to be Spider-Man.
Very looking forward to it. My daughter has a huge crush on Tom Holland. I actually saw that tickets were available at the theater up here, and I texted her today. I was like, you want to see 2D or 3D? She texted back 3D. I said, Tom Holland in 3D. Oh, yeah. She started laughing at me. So we had a new song with Friends was out. Stephen Kelly talked about Bob Seger's Night Moves and Third Eye Blind Semi-Charm Life. Great songs. The NBA team and this Week in Sports are all covering the NBA Finals, which may be done by the time this drops. I don't know exactly. It's up to the manager, Todd Weber, to decide that. I was also on the second episode of PTBN's E-Ticket Attraction with Jason Sherman as the host, and I guested along with Mr. Neil Trauma and Chad Campbell, and we talked everything Epcot. So be sure to check that out. That is a lot of fun if you're a theme park and Disney fan. Also, be sure to keep an eye on the social media feeds as the reboot of the Greatest Song of the 80s tournament is starting soon. I am heavily involved in that, and I can tell you that that it will be getting going. We're in the final stage of prep. Should be just another week or so, and then there will be a pod blast coming up featuring myself, the manager Todd Weber, Scott Criscolo, and J.R. Cena D'Amato, where we're going to sort of break down some of the matchups in the tournament and kind of give our picks for who we think is going to go far in the Greatest Song of the 80s tournament take two. We had some bot issues last year. And just also go over, check out the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed on the Place to Be podcast. They just reviewed SummerSlam 89 with Justin Scott and John D'Amato. We just talked about talking WCW with you guys. That was the natural Dustin Rhodes. I still hear that theme song in my head whenever I read that. And they call him the natural.
Yeah. And he's the son of a son and the son of a gun.
There you go. And then we had row one, seat one, Ben Zanny. He's cranking those episodes out every week, it seems like. His latest episode, he had underground pro promoter Kevin Koo and looked behind the scenes at the actually, he was Southern underground pro promoter Kevin Koo and got behind the scenes look at their latest event. And every other week, we hear Scott Criscoll, Nate Milton, and Steve Willey on the main event. So check out placetobenation.com. New articles go up every day. We have a big 1994 project that is starting soon, where we're going to have articles every Friday, like a Flashback Friday type thing, featuring all about everything went on that year, whether it's movies, music, sports, TV. So, you know, look for some Seinfeld-related stuff, probably, some Forrest Gump, Pulp Fiction all came out that year. The World Cup was that year, so we're going to have an article about that. We we have a lot of fun stuff going on at Place to Be Nation. So placetobenation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world. So, Greg, are you ready to get this show on the road, so to speak?
I was born ready, my friend.
All right. So we are both going to be watching this on the Netflix streaming service. So we have it both queued up to the beginning. Our counter say 000, right?
That's correct.
Okay. So when I'm going to count down and we're going to hit play. Okay. Here we go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, play. All right.
Perfect.
All right. New Line Cinema is revealing itself. I'm watching it on my PS4.
The first of several entities that will reveal themselves during the course of this movie.
Yes.
Rated PG-13, nudity and sex-related humor. Yeah, so New Line Cinema doing this movie. That's I actually have never had any memory of which studio did these, but I mainly knew New Line for the Nightmare on Elm Street movies when I was a kid.
Right. Mm-hmm. Oh, God, my closed caption is big.
So good.
So we're outside Vegas, and we see a white kitty cat with the aforementioned Dr. Evil.
Yes, the proto Mr. Bigglesworth, mm-hmm. pre-accident.
And we see almost like his Legion of Doom sitting there, so to speak. All these very stereotypical bad guys.
Including a young Will Ferrell.
Yes. You have a it looks like a Generalissimo.
Love this bit.
You know, you have the guy with the claw hand and the he's just offing all of his henchmen for not killing Austin Powers.
I love his fire pit too.
Yeah.
Yeah, Will Ferrell's character is just sweating up a sweating up a storm. I can't remember his character's name on here.
It's Mustafa.
Mustafa, yes, and he of course appears again in Spy Who Shagged Me. Our introduction to Mr. Powers. What a great sequence this is.
One of my favorite credit sequences.
Yeah.
Because you basically get everything you need to know about this guy in one song.
Oh, yeah. Right off the bat, we get... I mean, this song is so iconic. Our band plays this at halftime of football games at my college that I work for. And it's just such an iconic song at this point. Yeah. It's just perfect. I can hear it in my head as we're watching on mute as he does this dance with all the people in the background.
Yeah,
you know.
Actually, had my wedding party walked into this. My wedding to my ex-wife. Yes.
Amazing. Mm-hmm. That's amazing. And this is actually a bit here with the camera work that gets paid off in the second movie, where you see him working full time as a photographer outside.
Yeah, and the stop things here.
Yeah. You're a tiger. Now I'm not even shooting you.
And I'm spent.
and this movie has a lot of fun poking fun at the Brits.
Yeah.
One of the ways it does that is with Austin Powers and his kind of, shall we say, interesting teeth.
Yes. I know. I have bad teeth.
I get it. I'm British. I have bad teeth. Yeah, so good.
Well, it was actually this was kind of like a love letter to his dad. Because his dad was English, and was a huge fan of these spy movies from the 60s. I remember him talking about, like, his friends would come over, you know, growing up in Canada, and his dad would be like, hey, Michael, are you guys going to a party? And his friends would be like, why does your dad talk so funny, eh?
Yeah. And of course, that also explains the homage in Spy Who Shagged Me to it's my favorite movie, In Like Flint.
Yes. And there's Mimi Rogers as Mrs. Kensington.
Yes. It's sort of mimicking, of course, the James Bond and Moneypenny relationship.
Yeah, or the the woman du jour, the Bond girl.
Mm-hmm.
Oh God!
Hey. One of my favorite characters, Michael York, as Basil Exposition,
because that's really all his job is.
One of the great things to pay attention to in these movies is the fact that somehow here he looks that way, but in the second movie, he actually looks older in the '60s than he does in the 90s. just weird little bits like this. Here's Austin going to the club.
The
Electric Psychedelic Pussycat Swingers Club.
Yes. Actually had a PC game that was like Austin Powers trivia game guy years ago. And Demi Moore, I forgot she was one of the producers of this.
Oh, I didn't remember that either.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, it was a lot of fun, and a lot of it took place at the Psychedelic Pussycat Swingers Club.
Yeah, everything about this movie is wonderful. Like, when I first saw this, I instantly fell in love with it because I kind of grew up listening to 60s rock, you know, like my parents got me hooked on the Beatles and the Stones and all that stuff. And so I kind of always had this ideal of like 1960s England. And I don't know if it was like this at all, but this is sort of in my mind's eye. What I picture when I hear all those like British invasion bands and stuff now on the radio, I think of like it's hard for me not to think of Austin Powers and think of the various club members here.
It's a man, baby. Just decks a woman, and when he goes to her, it's a man. Judo chop.
Yes, Austin's intense knowledge of judo. He's ability to call all of his holds.
Yes, you could hear him calling the match.
And there was blatantly a stunt double by yes. Dr. Evil.
And that becomes a trend too. Like the henchmen just get killed off by their own people. That happens in the beginning of the second one. There he goes in the cryo freezing chamber.
Come, Mr. Bigglesworth.
See you in the future, Mr. Powers. He's freezing himself.
Another beautiful thing about this movie, it was done on largely a shoestring budget.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there's this movie does not have a substantial budget. They don't have financial backing that they would have in later entries in the series, but it still looks good. Like it still looks, you know, it's entertaining and it's fun. And the stuff that looks bad is intended to look bad.
Yeah. Well, sometimes, you know, it works out when the cat on the window, it looks like one of those things you put on your car. But yeah, sometimes it's better if there's no technology or something doesn't work. Like Jaws, had that shark worked, that movie would not have been as good. I'm sorry.
Absolutely. Absolutely. No, you're right. You're right. This is these movies are also great in terms of all the supporting like players, like Clint Howard.
Yes.
Here. This guy on the right, I can't remember this actor's name, but he's been in so many movies, especially in the 90s.
Yes. I remember him.
And always playing kind of like a government stooge.
Yes. Is that Charles Napier?
I think it might be.
Yeah, it says Commander Gilmore. I'm looking on the IMDb. Yeah, that is. That's Charles Napier. Huh. over Nevada. Big Boy's gone. Well, he never left, sir. He's always been offering. Do they have those in the South, Big Boys?
No.
I think it's mostly a West Coast thing.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah. No, I've never seen one in real life. I always thought it was made up for the movies until I got into college.
Oh, yeah. I went to one when I was about 7 years old. My aunt lived outside of San Diego. We were out there for the summer. And they had something like Abdallah's Big Boy. I don't know if it was the same chain, but that was more of a New England thing. But.
Volunteered to have himself frozen in case Dr. Evil ever returned. And here's
take it out of Demolition Man.
Here's the first of all of the many scenes that my friends and I still quote to this day, coming up in just a moment.
Gary Coleman.
When he comes out of the chamber, evacuation, and then evacuate. Every time one of my friends goes to take a leak in my guest bathroom, that's a joke that gets brought up.
That's too funny. He gets frozen while his hands are over his little winky there.
Yes, and his impressive mane of chest hair, which I can admire. As a hairy man, I can admire Austin Powers and his atomic bomb chest hair.
Yeah, they put him in the goo, kind of just like almost out of Demolition Man.
You are hairy like animal, Austin Powerovich.
Oh, you are hairy.
Yes. Warm liquid goo phase complete.
Reanimation beginning. Reanimation complete.
Got a little Terminator in here. Mm-hmm. You know. Cleansing. We got to get here. Now we're about to get to the evacuation phase here in just a second.
He's like so out of it. It's like when you're trying to walk a drunk friend to the car from the bar.
Yeah.
I had a friend of mine. That was him every time. Walked into a pole. We had to go to this one pizza place to get a chicken roll. He would throw it up by the time we got him home. It was like a normal Saturday night back in the early to mid 90s.
or like a weekend at the Duke household.
Oh, here we go. Here's your scene, Greg.
Yes. Evacuation beginning.
Urinates heavily. That's what it says in the closed caption.
Yep. And that's always this scene gets brought up every time one of us has to take a leak.
I love the and then he puts the hand on the wall, because what man has not done that?
Oh, absolutely.
It's so fun. Sometimes you're just so tired that you just don't want to stand.
Yep. You lean on the hand. Sometimes you have to switch hands. Yeah. You know?
Urination stops.
Stop, yeah.
Your evacuation cup. Urination resumes. This is actually a little funnier on closed captioning.
And Michael York is great here too, just with the facial reactions to everything.
trickling
legs. Yep.
They're trying to just get through it.
And this guy on the right was great too. The
Russian
was on the far right, just looking completely perplexed by the whole situation.
It's 19.
So what do I do? When did you first see this movie? Did you see it in theaters?
Yeah, I saw it in theaters. I was about 24, 25 when this came out. So I probably brought my then girlfriend to see this. And, it was a lot of fun. I mean, what was I doing in 97? I don't think I had just started working. I was an intern / PA, so I was still DJing a little bit. But yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was instantly quotable.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Finally, those capitalist pigs.
Yay, comrades. Oh, yeah, yay, capitalism.
Yeah, capitalism. Sorry, I didn't interrupt.
That's okay. That wasn't a great story anyway. I mean, I just remember going to see it, though. That's kind of
boring. Jeez.
Miss Kensington. Mrs. Kensington. No. She's long since retired.
Austin, Miss Kensington is her daughter. And here we see the lovely Elizabeth Hurley.
Yowie wowie.
Yowie wowie. Huzzah. Hugh Grant is a moron.
God. Yeah, Foxy Brown or whatever the hell he did, whatever her name was, who he got caught fucking around with.
Jeez, come on, man.
I mean, between this and even though it's a shit movie, what was that? Bedazzled?
Oh my God, Bedazzled.
That yes. One scene where she's got the bikini on with the snake and the apple in the hand. Oh, God.
Yep.
Hachi to the serious machi.
She did a movie also with Matthew Perry where she was smoking hot. And I can't remember the name of it.
Yeah, she was like a con artist or something, right?
Yeah, that's exactly right. She was a con artist.
Things have changed. Well, as long as people are having, you know, unprotected sex and have mind-blowing drugs.
I love all the man out of time jokes here.
Austin Danger
Powers. It says here, name Danger Powers. Oh, here we go. Danger is my middle
name. And I love the look he gives her, and she's trying not to laugh.
Already trying to seduce her, and all she can do is just laugh at him. One blue crushed velvet suit. One frilly lace cravat. One silver medallion with male symbol.
Buongiorno, boys. I say that's something I quote a lot too. I say buongiorno, boys.
Now, Bacharach, it's one Swedish maid, penis enlarger pump. Also, this gets brought up all the time. We used to have an air mattress that we'd have to inflate for when people would stay over at my apartment, and every time we would hook the little pump up to it. It's not mine, baby. Honest.
One credit card receipt warranty. Somebody's pulling a prank on me.
Ate my bag, baby. One book, Swedish made penis enlarger pumps and me. This sort of thing is my bag, baby, by Austin Powers.
You know what's funny is, I don't know if you ever noticed this, this guy is actually in Goldmember.
No.
He's the guy that makes him, he does like the medical exam when he's on top of Mini-Me, like they're doing that.
Wow. I don't think I never picked up on that.
Yeah. It's one of those things, like, you watch these movies enough times sometimes, you know, you're like, wow. Or, like, one night I'm watching Forgetting Sarah Marshall, and during the scene where Jason Segel's sitting at the bar, and he does that, like, look at me, I'm Samantha. Mm. I swear to God, I paused it, and it looked like, what's her face, Miranda, Cynthia Nixon, walks by. It just blew my mind. Like when I pointed it out to Russell, he was like, "What the fuck?"
Yeah.
She must have just been in Hawaii that day.
Yeah, jeez, that's crazy. It's amazing the stuff that you can find in movies that you love that you've seen a million times.
Yeah,
that you just never noticed. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to my underground lair.
Oh yeah, this is another great scene.
Yeah. The bit with the penis enlarger is just a classic, but instantly Austin is just such a lovable character, you know, like he's so mischievous and, you know, happy go lucky.
Look what you did to Mr. Bigglesworth.
You were unable to anticipate feline complications to the reanimation process. And there goes Mustafa.
Not the first time he gets, he goes a slow, horrible death.
Yeah. Let this be a reminder to you all that this organization will not tolerate failure. Mustafa is the unsung. It's so serendipitous the timing of this show because just yesterday I was going to lunch with my boss, and my boss brought up the character of Mustafa from the series, and he said Will Ferrell's character in Austin Powers was just so great and so forgotten. And I was like, you know, he really is. Because there's so many great bits in this movie, you kind of forget about this.
And sometimes these bits go on for a while in the background while they're trying to talk. Finally, he just like has to pick up the phone. Yeah, not dead. Burned.
Not dead.
Badly.
He's still down there.
I do. I have a cat sometimes, and I hold him like Mr. Bigglesworth and pet him. I would never own one of those ugly things, but my guy is orange and white, and I actually just got a second cat.
I'm glad you found me. Thank you. I'm very badly burned, so if you could just
just shoot some.
You shot me. You shot me right in the arm.
So he's burned and now shot.
And then the look from Dr. Evil, just making sure. Okay.
Right.
Right.
Let me introduce you all, Frau Farbissima, the militant wing of the Salvation Army. Random task.
Korean ex-wrestler.
As obviously a knockoff on Oddjob.
Oddjob. Mm-hmm. A beautiful parody.
Mm-hmm. Instead of the hat he threw.
Played by UFC veteran Joe Sun.
Oh, okay.
Yes. Now, interesting story about Joe Sun. He is most famous for being the guy in one of the early UFCs, I believe it was UFC 4, who fought a guy named Keith Hackney. And this is the guy, Keith Hackney took him down and punched him repeatedly in the dick and balls.
Oh, Jesus.
Until he eventually went unconscious and lost.
Yes, they're always after me, Lucky Charms.
So Joe Sun, after getting punched in the balls, apparently went off the deep end and became just a nasty man, a rapist, and everything else. Oh. So he's in prison.
Oh, lovely. Yeah.
But he's great in this movie. And
Paddy O'Brien. Hey, Leprechaun Man, why don't you give me your Lucky Charms?
Why is everybody already saying that?
I love the face that she makes after, like, you know, he doesn't, like, get her explanation. And she's just like, okay. We come to my number two. His name? Number two. The great Robert Wagner.
Oh, Robert Wagner is brilliant.
Yes.
The legitimate face of my evil empire.
Dr. Evil, over the last 30 years, VirtueCon has grown by leaps and bounds.
They really don't need to be evil anymore. They have so much money and power. The old cable companies in 38 fucking states.
Oh, my God. And imagine the money you could make as a cable company in the 90s.
Yes. Shipping, oil refineries, and a factory in Chicago that makes miniature models of factories.
This is so freaking clever. This movie is so well written.
He gets taken off screen.
Great sight gags.
Yes.
Everything just works. The voices are funny. The gags are funny. The characters are funny. The writing is so smart and funny. these are so amazing.
These plans, yes.
Yeah. Dr. Evil's big evil plan. Seeing that Prince Charles has had an affair outside of marriage and therefore would have to divorce.
He did have an affair. He admitted to it. Now they are divorced. Right, people. You have to tell me these things. I do use that too. I'm the boss. Need the info.
I had a Dr. Evil figure that when I was a teenager that you pulled a string on him and he said all these catchphrases. Yes. And that was one of them. I'm the boss. Need the info.
Throw me a frickin' bone here.
Which was, in essence, a sophisticated heat beam, which we called a
laser.
Of course, everyone still does that.
Yes, the finger quotes.
And the protective layer, which we call the ozone layer. Slowly but surely, ultraviolet radiation. All of his plans are, like, so long form. Like, they're always, like, these elaborate things that would take years to accomplish.
And they've already happened.
I mean, even in the initial phases, like, our plan is to eventually force make it look like Charles has had an affair out of wedlock and then force him to get a divorce.
And that's actually one of the few swears in the movie. He's like, oh, shit. Let's just, you know, hijack some nuclear weapons and have a ransom.
So what about the country of Kriplakistan?
Kriplakistan.
Many times myself.
Yes.
Here it is. $1 million. Don't you think we should maybe ask for more than a few million dollars? $1 million? Exactly, a lot of money these days.
They make $9 billion a year. Well, that's a lot more, yes. And I still do the pinky to the mouth, too, all the time.
And I love how unsure he is. $100 billion? Oh, this is great, too. Austin's first attempt to seduce Vanessa on the plane.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I was a huge Mike Myers fan for just from his SNL days of all of his. I had the best of Mike Myers on VHS. And so I fell in love with even the more obscure skits like Lothar of the Hill People.
I am Lothar of the Hill People.
Hill People.
Yes. Or the, you like the juice. The juices are good.
Yes. Or Scottish toothpaste.
Oh, yeah. Or all things Scottish. Yeah. If it's not Scottish, it's crap.
Yeah, he did the toothpaste commercial or whatever where they're talking about, you need this new – is English toothpaste. That's what it was. And it mainly remembered for Chris Farley saying, and it tastes great on a cracker.
I've been frozen for 30 years. I see if my bits and pieces.
You're working. And then, of course, the Austin, you get the Wayne's World movies, which were phenomenal. Mm-hmm. And then So I Married an Axe Murderer, which is so underrated classic.
Maybe a future episode of Laughing Theater there.
Yes, a lot of the sort of ingredients in So I Married an Axe Murderer would later play out in the Austin Powers movies.
Yes. I remember seeing actually Mike Myers, Dana Carvey, and Chris Rock live. They were doing like a college tour.
Oh, wow.
I want to say this is like 90, 91. I must have been a freshman in college. Yeah. Wayne's World was hit, and they all did stand up, and then at the end, they did a Wayne's World skit in the, this was up at the University of Hartford, where I went my first 2.5 years.
Oh, that's phenomenal.
It was great.
I never knew that Mike Myers ever did stand up.
Yeah. He didn't do it that much, but I think he may have done it in Canada a bit. Yeah, but he did. He was kind of funny. He's definitely more of a skit guy, though.
Right, right. Carvey's stand-up is
great. Oh, yeah. Oh, these high heels, I fell over again.
Oh, I will never have sex with you, ever. If you were the last man on Earth and I was the last woman on Earth, and the future of the human race depended on our having sex simply for procreation, I still would not have sex with you.
So what's your point, Vanessa?
What's your point?
Oh, Lord. So great. So great.
You could tell that like somewhere in there she finds him somewhat charming.
Yeah. How could you not find him charming? He's just – he's everything about the 60s that's wonderful.
Yes.
There's a wonderful transition. Remember when we froze your semen?
So that part of you could live forever.
Oh, sure. Here's a very young Seth Green coming in as a...
God! This made my friend crack up because my other best friend, Scott, he's like, I think he was with me too in the theater, and he leans over and goes, sounds like my mother. Scott!
I also love that his name is Scott Evil.
Yeah, Scott Evil. I'm your father.
Dr. Evil. Reminds me of when in the Attitude Era when they would introduce Shane McMahon and his father, Mr. McMahon.
Come here, give me a hug.
Hug.
Give me a hug, please. Come here. No. And he walks over like slowly, like, I'm hip. And he does the Macarena.
I'm hip. Oh, I remember this like perfectly. Don't look at me like a frickin' Frankenstein. Give your father a hug.
He does.
Hug. Hug.
Get away from me, you lazy-eyed psycho.
My family, actually. We would always do that. But my mom would do that to embarrass me when my friends were over sometimes.
Old Vegas right there. Actually, I've never been to that part of Vegas. I've been to Vegas twice, but I've never been
to Vegas.
Oh, it's great. You have so much energy there, literally. Frank Marino's Joan Rivers.
Between this movie and I think Vegas Vacation came out the same year, I got a lot of exposure to Vegas in 1997 on the big screen, or on the small screen, as it were.
Yeah, Swingers was – what was Swingers? 96, I think? I don't know. I was on the second episode with the manager. We did Swingers.
Another movie I've never seen, actually.
Oh, Greg, you have to see that. Oh, you'd love it. There are some good scenes. There are some painful scenes in that movie.
It's amazing all the classic movies I haven't watched. I had not seen The Shawshank Redemption until like 2 years ago.
Well, yeah, I hadn't seen The Godfather until like 5 or 6 years ago.
Hey, yeah, it happens. It's just impossible to catch all the classics that you want to watch. But Swingers is definitely one of those that's on my list to watch at some point.
I got crap on the last year in pot for not seeing One Flew Over Cuckoo's Nest.
I've never seen it either. So
my daughter has.
High five. Right. Your daughter's seen it and you haven't?
They had showed it in like her psych class.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Nerd alert. And then her gut is like 10 times the size of his.
Oh, Lord. Yeah.
And there's the Swedish made penis larger again. Somebody's playing a prank on me.
And that's totally a me thing, by the way. That's the me thing, that if something embarrassing is in there, even though it's blatantly mine, rather than just ignoring it and moving on, I'll call attention to the fact that it's there and be like, oh, this is not mine. How'd that get in there? That's not my porn collection. What's going on here?
Those are not my beads. What?
Oh, I didn't kill that guy. Wait a second here.
And now, so you recognize the dealer, right? Do you know who that is?
I'm not a big Seinfeld fan, but isn't that the soup Nazi from Seinfeld?
That it is, the soup Nazi.
Oh, this is the scene I was referencing earlier. The Black Jet scene here. To me, this is a perfect movie scene.
Yes.
I would submit this against any scene in any movie as being just – there's nothing wrong with it.
I could really
– The fact that his eye patch x-ray vision says eye patch x-ray vision.
And he hits on 17, I like to live dangerously.
Austin's inquisitive look. Oh.
And the girl plays a lot of vagina. She was in a lot of stuff back then. Yeah. You know, five.
I'll stay. I suggest you hit, sir. I also like to live dangerously. And then the sigh. They didn't put the sigh on there. As you wish, sir. Is 20 beat your 5? Well, I won't lie to you. Cards aren't my bag, baby.
Allow myself to introduce myself.
I'm Richie Cunningham, and this is my wife, Oprah.
I love her face. She's like, what? My name is number 2.
My name is number 2.
Her name, Alana Vagina. What? Come again.
What a vagina. I'm sorry, I'm just not getting it. It sounded like you said your name was a lot of...
Okay, never mind.
Mind. Which later on he'll say, kiss your mother with that mouth. Lord, she's falling out of that top. Jeez. Yes. Rendezvous back at the hotel suite. Oh, another classic. This is just one classic scene after another.
Yes.
I mean, this is just brilliant. This is one of those movies where I would have loved to just observe the writing process for this. Because
the blind guy has the man.
Another great line that one of my favorite lines. You didn't happen to see anything at all. I use that line so much. My friends that, like, my buddy David Sunday probably wants to kill me at this point for how many times I've used that exact line. You don't happen to see anything at all.
Tom Arnold, actually funny in this scene.
Arnold, amazing in this movie.
Yes.
This and True Lies are really his proudest moments. That is one crazy getup you got there, fella. Hey, are you in the show? No, actually, I'm English. That's a line I used on my boss yesterday.
I've used that all the time, too, because I actually am. My last name is English Welsh last name. So people will ask me, and I'll go, actually, it's English. Have a good one.
Have a good one.
Don't really talk.
Show that turd who's boss. Here comes the Lucky Charms man. Uh. We've all been there before in Tom Arnold's position where you're sitting next to someone and they're just having I've been on both sides of the equation. I've been the struggler and I've been the person listening to the struggler.
Yeah. It's just, sometimes you just want to kind of just get out of there.
Yeah. You're just like, oh God, how quickly can I make this pass? Get out of here. I'll be around for this.
And when you hear the certain sounds, it's like, oh, we need to get out.
Yeah. How about a courtesy flush, buddy? Who does number two work for? Show that turd who's boss.
Just grab a hold of something, bite your lip, and give it hell.
My grandfather, this was his favorite scene in the movie. He would quote this endlessly for the couple years after this came out. Well, that sounds pretty nasty. How about a courtesy flush over there? He'd come by and knock on the door when you're in the bathroom and say that to you.
Yes. God damn, boy.
Did you eat? Oh, man.
It's like lovely transitions.
I love these transition bits, too. I was going to say with the
Out of Rowan and Martin's laughing.
BBC One, BBC Two, BBC Three, BBC Four.
Kreplak extent. I think that's named after Kreplak, which is a Jewish dish.
Oh.
Yeah, I remember. I'm gonna hit the Google.
$100 billion.
So Kreplak is actually a small dumpling filled with ground meat, mashed potatoes, or another filling, usually boiled or served in chicken soup.
Look at these stereotypes in this UN room, by the way.
The background. And there's another sign for reference. That's Babu.
The guy talking?
Yeah. Very bad, Jerry. Very, very, very bad. That's Babu. I will, Babu!
And he's a sumo wrestler and a matador. Hey, Tito Santana. Found something to do with him.
Maybe also play Raj's dad on Big Bang Theory. All these suits come in. I have no idea who these guys are.
And just linger just long enough for it to get awkward. So any comic book fans that are listening, the guy on the far left here looks a little bit like Jim Steranko.
Oh, okay. We have the typical, they all very look alike, you know. A couple guys look like they could have been in The Godfather.
Yeah. Yeah. Rao was wearing a suit that I can't even really describe. A black jacket that looks so slick that it defies belief. Ah, here is the usage of the clever usage of food to cover Austin's naughty parts.
Yes. And other props as well. Which they actually do again later.
Mm-hmm.
And then also in the second one, I believe, too.
That's correct. Yep. See his mane of pubic hair sticking out from over her hand.
You could be a second. It was the 60s. Bad teeth didn't matter. Oh, the upside down.
So good.
And, you know, who doesn't do naked, stretches with a cup of coffee in your hand?
Yeah, I mean, why not?
That's how most people start their day. And now he has champagne.
This is my morning routine before work, actually. I have to do all this to wake up.
A little champagne, a little stretch. And then the sausage. And then she takes a ginormous bite with her mouth wide open. All right, love you, mommy, but I have to go.
That VirtueCon worldwide headquarters looks pretty cool, I gotta say.
Yeah, I'd go on a tour there.
Yeah.
And a giant telephoto lens.
That's Dr. Evil's cat. I never forget a pussy cat.
She got the little spy camera. Darling,
Go on, Vanessa.
He goes back to his photographer roots. He can't deny his instincts.
Come on, we're in the middle of this mission, but I'm going to take you out for a night in a town.
And this is where we meet Mr. Burt Bacharach for the first time in the series.
And eating bangers and mash, it looks like.
So what are bangers and mash? I don't even know.
You don't know what that is?
No.
Bangers are sausage and mash is mashed potatoes.
Oh, wow.
Those clever Brits. Yeah, some of their names aren't too us. But then there's also a British dessert called Spotted Dick.
I believe I've had that before.
And you can get that in a can, too.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Burt Bacharach. I love that, by the way, that Burt Bacharach has nothing better to do than just to play piano for random couples on the back of this, whatever this is, this bus.
Her Majesty's Vegas tours.
Yeah.
A very travelogue-ish.
So you were a little bit older. Had you ever heard of Burt Bacharach before this movie? Because I had not.
Yes, I had heard of him. I just didn't know much about him. I mean, I knew...
I'll be honest with you, for several years after this movie, I thought – well, not for several years, for 2 years until the sequel came out. I thought he was a made-up person. I thought he was a character in the movie.
And they're playing Twister.
Good Lord. To have played Twister with 1997 Elizabeth Hurley.
Oh, my God. That is just what dreams are made of.
Yes. Imagine 13-year-old me watching this movie, too. Ah!
This is something Mike Myers does quite often. Does this little routine.
I love this.
Take the stairs.
This was my favorite. Weirdly enough, this might have been my favorite bit in the movie when I first saw it when I was a kid.
You try to replicate it. It's not that easy.
Yeah, it's hard. It's difficult. I figured it out eventually, but it's very hard. Well, I figured out the elevator. The canoe is quite difficult.
We're going to take the elevator. I love the fact he looks at his watch while he's doing it.
Look at the watch.
Come on, champagne with me.
Okay. All right. Okay. Oh, I tripped.
Oh. I'm sorry. Why? That bug up your ass had to die.
Oh, man. It's so good, man. Like, you love Austin. You love Vanessa. It's like it's just a fun movie. In a nutshell. I don't get into this nutshell.
It's bloody.
Bloody great nutshell. Shell has a nut like this.
Look at you. You're smashed.
Is Austin Powers one of the originators of dad jokes?
Probably. But Austin is a gentleman.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're drunk.
It's not right.
All right, well, tell me about my mummy. I don't know, man. Elizabeth Hurley is hot, but Mimi Rogers looks pretty damn good in this movie herself.
Yeah.
Even when they try to make her older. They just throw a little gray streak in her hair.
Do they? They never show Mr. Kensington, right?
No.
Maybe that could be a plot thread they re-examine in a fourth one. Since they well, it does turn out that Vanessa was a fembot all along.
Yeah.
Spoiler alert for those that are watching.
Yeah. Haven't seen this 22-year-old movie. Yes.
They knew she was a fembot the whole time. Apparently. Yeah.
Well, that was what he wanted. He wanted to have a different girl in every movie.
Right.
Heather Graham, they actually are deleted scenes of Heather Graham in Goldmember.
Really?
Yeah. I've never seen them, but I've heard that she was in like a couple of parts of the movie.
Oh, my God.
Hello, Austin. I love this. When he looks forward, he's like, look, I got mail.
look at this 1997 internet, too.
That's almost the same as Southern internet, I guess.
Yes, this is actually what videos play like now where I'm at.
Yeah, one of the best lines on Looking Forward, Looking Back was we lost Jenny towards the end of the show, and we just hear Russell go, that's Southern internet for you.
It's true. We've all lived it. All of us down here know the terrors of Southern internet.
The agony. So we're at a lot of vaginas, penthouse.
Who hasn't been once or twice in their life in the penthouse of someone named a lot of vagina?
I have.
Yeah. I mean, cover. A lot of passage in some areas.
Secret projects, Carrot Top
movie. Human organ trafficking, Carrot Top movie. Okay, best Carrot Top related line of all time, Norm MacDonald or Conan with the, you're going to be in a movie with Carrot Top? And the lady goes, Allison from Melrose Place was on the show. She goes, yes, I am going to be in a movie with Carrot Top. Hey, I know what the title of the movie is. Box Office Poison.
You know what? My favorite Carrot Top thing is how he shows up during the end credits of The Hangover when they're looking at the pictures on the phone, on the camera.
Oh, yeah.
And you see him, he's there, he's doing coke and all that. Let me slip in something more comfortable.
I love that. You just did, baby.
Fabiana Udenio. That's the actress's name. And she was in a lot of stuff. If I could get my damn computer to work correct tonight.
Northern Internet.
Northern. Yeah, it's something. Or there, it's just my Mac is just being wonky. Of course, I have my handy-dandy iPhone standing right here.
Once again, this is not the best scene to watch with your 13-year-old with your parents.
Oh, my God, yes.
Oh, this is another good bit coming up here.
Oh, yeah.
In Japan, men come first and women come second. Well, sometimes not at all.
Oh, that's where I know her from. She was in Summer School.
With Dangerfield?
No, that was Back to School. Summer School was the Mark Harmon, Courtney Thorne Smith, Dean Cameron vehicle.
Oh, wow.
She's also in Jane the Virgin. Yeah, I remember seeing it years ago. That's where I remember her from. She played like a foreign exchange student. And it takes him forever to get his clothes off. His
frilly shirt off.
He comes in holding his... There's
groovy, baby.
Yeah,
I love this bit coming up.
You're like, oh,
oh, that's the spot. Yes. Yes, what?
Yeah, so business card, Austin Powers,
International Management Street. So that's why they call it that. In Japan, men come first and women come second. I love this line.
Sometimes not at all.
Not at all. And he loves his own jokes.
Suck it to me, baby.
How dare you break wind before me? I'm sorry, baby. I didn't know it was your turn.
One of my friends say that all the time. Pardon me for being rude. It was not me.
It was my food. It just popped up to say hello, but now it's gone back down below. It's the simple pleasures in life.
Yeah. You always try to avoid that whenever you're in a tub or something with a young lady.
Yes. Pardon me for being rude. It was not me. It was my food. Yes. This and testicle spectacles, wallet, and
watch. Yes, that's right.
Are always the go-tos for me in just about any social setting.
Yes. When isn't? That's the spot.
Sort of like a reflex test at the doctor.
Yes. Yeah, doctor. The great Mindy Sterling.
Oh, she's so good in these movies. Really funny.
Bring in the Fenbox! I think Cindy. I think Cindy Margolis is one of these Fembots. She was a very famous pinup model at the time.
Nancy Sinatra's Boots Are Made for Walking playing in the background.
There's giving me a lot of choices for our playout song here.
Every time I hear that song, this is the movie that comes to mind.
Kill These Women. They're like, hey, how you doing? He covers Mr. Bigglesworth's
eyes. Hi, lady.
Boob guns.
Machine gun jubblies.
And smoke start coming out the jumblies. I like to see girls of that.
Of that caliber.
Caliber.
By caliber, of course, I mean but the size of their gun barrels and the high quality of their character. The homonym.
A lot of, awkward humor, I guess you want to call it, or whatever it's called.
In some ways ahead of its time in that regard. Yeah. Because that's kind of become sort of like the my generation's kind of style of comedies, that just thriving on the awkward.
Mm-hmm. Very shagadetic. All right, let me guess. The floss, the toothpaste, the explosives.
Beautiful send up. This movie is such a wonderful send up of the Bond movies as well. You know, your classic Q giving away the secret weapons, but no, it's just toothpaste. Evolved dentistry since the 60s.
Hello, exposition.
Alston, let me bring you up to speed.
Oh, crap, that gets done. I love this line.
Well, you think scare me, and what is nuclear war? What's the other one? This is the other one. This is the number one. Quoted line for this.
Connie's.
Circus folk. Nomads, you know. Smell like cabbage. Small hands.
And I love that, the reference to that in Goldmember.
I knew I smelled cabbage.
I thought I smelled cabbage. that was perfect casting. Yeah, Michael Caine.
Oh, absolutely.
Michael Caine as Nigel Powers. I thought I smelled cabbage.
Okay. He's a bloody tripod.
I tell you, I want to do Miss Congeniality on this show just for Michael Caine.
The good news is you can use it as a kickstand.
Top draw, Kensington. This is my mother.
That's this not is... your mother. That's a man, baby. Good God, man.
He just knocks this poor old lady out. Oh!
Oh, this wig.
Come off! Yeah, hold on 1 second. No, that's my mother!
Oh, man. Michael York is an unsung part of this movie. He really, I don't know that anyone else could have played this role quite as effectively as him. He's just so distinguished and British, and he's, you're talking about my mother.
You have to admit, she is rather monish.
That is a woman. It does look like she was beaten with an ugly stick.
Did you ever see that, what was that other movie? Now that he's sitting there with a turban, what was that other movie?
He's going through his Beatles Indian phase.
Yeah. Oh, great Carrie Fisher. What was that movie he did? The Guru or something?
Love Guru.
Love Guru. It just looks so stupid.
It looked so bad, yeah. Hey, was that the guy that plays Champ in Anchorman?
David Koechner?
Yeah.
It might have been, yeah. And the other guy was speaking of Miss Congeniality. That was Creepy Frank.
So, story here. When I was the editor of our school paper, we always did this fall camp for new incoming students called Camp Trop. And everybody would come in. The editors would introduce everybody to the editorial staff and introduce us to each other. And so when my first semester as editor, the new batch of freshmen were in and everything, and we were going around introducing ourselves. And it got to me, and they're like, tell us about yourself. And I was like,
Oh, the details. Very well, where to begin?
Yes, I've done. My friend did that once.
My father was a relentlessly self-improving boulangerie owner from Belgium with low-grade narcolepsy and a penchant for buggery.
He made outlandish statements like he invented the question mark. He also often accused chestnuts of being lazy. An evil petting zoo?
The sort of general malaise that the genius possess and the insane lament.
Oh, I am trying to
My
kill him.
My father would womanize. He would drink. In the winter, we made meat helmets. Pretty standard stuff, really.
Luge lessons.
He's quite wily, like his old man. Yeah, this is one of the great monologues in cinema history to me.
Yes.
Many would point to Casablanca. I would point to this.
The details of my life are quite inconsequential.
Consequential.
Oh, very well.
I begin. My father was a relentlessly self-improving boulangerie owner from Belgium with low-grade narcolepsy and a penchant for buggery. My mother was a 15-year-old French prostitute named Chloe with webbed feet. Father would womanize. He would drink. He'd make outrageous claims like he invented the question mark. Sometimes he would accuse chestnuts of being lazy. Sort of general malaise that only the genius possess and the insane lament. My childhood was typical. Summers in Rangoon, luge lessons. In the spring, we'd make meat helmets. When I was insolent, I was placed in a burlap bag and beaten with reeds. Pretty standard stuff, really. At the age of 12, I received my first bribe. At the age of 14, an Austrian named Vilma ritualistically shaved my testicles. There really is nothing quite like a shorn scrotum. It's breathtaking. I suggest you try it.
Awesome job. Greg Phillips, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.
The rich little of Place to Me Nation.
It's amazing what you can do when you have no friends as a child.
I mean, I've done voices since I was a kid too. And you just sit there and practice and just do the lines. Like, do you find like some voices you have to do a certain line to get into the voice?
Oh yes, absolutely. 100%. Totally. Like not with every voice, but there are some voices that I can only deliver certain lines.
Yeah. It's very hard.
Like if you're doing a Jesse Ventura, it's hard not to say gorilla.
Yeah.
It's part of it. You know, like, why don't you take that back there, gorilla? You know, something like that.
Oh, he shagged the Italian bird. You wear a condom? No. Only sailors do.
Only sailors wear condoms. Not in the 90s, also, where they should, the filthy buggers. They go from port to port.
A lot of men, nothing to me.
Sailors wear condoms.
Can't just go off shagging anybody.
This is where Austin gets the unfortunate task of trying to catch up on the last 20 years of... or 30 years of history. Mm-hmm. Realizes all his friends that have passed on.
All his, shag another, partners.
Another legendary line as a result. Two legendary lines coming up as a result of this part.
I love that car, too.
Oh, that's a beautiful car.
I was telling Jenny during Dumb and Dumber how there's no Mutt Cuts collectible car. I have a collection on my desk at work, and I swear that like 50 of them probably Matchbox cars, but they're all from TV and movies. So I have Ecto-1, I have like Ford DeLoreans, I have,
oh yeah,
you know, the cars from like Rockford Files, Magnum PI, the van from A-Team, the van from Old School. It's so great. And that Austin Powers car, that would be a great addition if they ever came out one.
Deceased Janis Joplin, deceased alcohol, Mama Cass, deceased ham sandwich.
Then he takes out a bird CD. It's not a bird movie.
Tries to play it on the record player.
Oh, God. I remember those sneakers with the pumps.
Yep.
Oh, geez.
Those were like so cool when I was a kid. We all wanted them. Mm-hmm. I don't think anybody at my school had them at the time when I was real little. And then they went out of fashion by the time I got to like middle school and was able to buy my own shoes.
All those cans of Tab. You know, what other movie featured Tab?
Not many.
I think it was Back to the Future, I think, had it. Was it Back to the Future? No. I think Michael J. Fox drank Tab on... It was definitely a Michael J. Fox thing. I think he drank it on...
Berlin Wall.
Maybe on Family Ties. I don't know. I just remember that line. Give me a Tab. Well, I can't give you a Tab unless you order something. Well, it's just a Pepsi free. If you want a Pepsi, pal, you got to pay for it.
Yeah. Another legendary line there. And I can't believe Liberace was gay. I mean, women loved it.
I didn't see that one coming. On a tour. Let's see. We have a blonde cowgirl.
And the love guru.
And the love guru, basically. I think you're shagadelic, baby.
You're switched on. You're smashing. Italian bird. She's the village bicycle. Everyone's had a ride.
You know, it's a door leading to a restricted area. That most tourists tell you that. And you have these interesting shaped people. The kind of large woman and the tall, lurch-sized man.
And he goes, he's shorter than her.
Yes.
And he goes after the tall guy.
And she fits,
and it fits perfectly.
And she fits quite snugly in the, you know, the large lady's outfit. How many tour guides, like, you know, like that? Oh, the steamroller. Judo chop.
Judo chop. Such an influential movie.
Steamroller is not exactly the the vehicle you want to use when you're trying to outrun somebody.
No, no. Although, Lord help me, if they ever put this in a video game and let you play with the steamroller, oh, gosh, it would be amazing. And this is the guy from Mad TV.
Yeah, Michael McDonald. Henchman, yep. Steve.
And he gets flat.
I think they did like a short on like his family or something. Like a comedic little short. Or like a DVD bonus feature or something.
I got to check that out if they have it.
I remember something. I don't know. I remember maybe a sketch.
Oh, they fell. Austin and Vanessa fell victim to the oldest of wrestling holds, the double noggin knocker.
You don't see that a lot these days.
No, you don't.
It's more of an 80s thing.
Yeah, it used to be. I mean, hell, back in the 80s and 90s, you can attest to this as well, that when you would be walking, if you had to be careful, if you're walking next to just one person, sometimes bad guys would just come out of the shadows and clunk your heads together, and you'd be unconscious for hours.
Yes, or they would come up to you, and they would clap their hands behind your head.
Yeah, and it would sting your ears.
Yes.
These kids these days don't understand that. They don't know what it was like back then. It was a very dangerous place, the world.
My subterranean drill, does that make you horny?
Does it make you horny?
Like, not now. I'm going to go liquid
so
hot magma.
You penetrate the Earth's crust.
Liquid magma.
Liquid hot magma. You know, we were talking earlier about possible WWE legends and some of these characters. Mm-hmm. As I'm reading this dialogue here, I wonder if maybe JR might fit better as Dr.
Than Beavis and Butthead. Very.
Here's
90s.
A cut in from my beloved Beavis and Butthead show from back then.
Yeah, what would JR as Dr. Evil sound like?
Oh, I don't know. Let me think. Oh, do you like your quasi-futuristic clothes, Mr. Powers? Whoever designed them must have been a pretty clever guy. Must have been a pretty smart guy. Huh? Must have had a mind for this business.
And then maybe like somebody like John Laurinaitis as Austin Powers, you know, he would be something like, Dr. Evil, you're never going to get away with this.
No, oh, Scott, my boy. Now, Scott, much like Stone Cold, I'm going to need you to stop running your mouth.
Like, oh, get out. Like, oh, he comes in like such a stoner.
Fascinating. Now, what are these evil plans that you have? That's how you'd like to live your life. I mean, listen, everybody's got a right to live their life how they want to live it. That you want to live your life looking at pornography, that's fine. Oh!
Won't you meet Daddy's nemesis, Austin Powers? And then Scott says, you're feeding him? Why don't you just kill him? I'm going to put him in an easily escapable situation.
Well, you just assume everything. I've heard this elaborate and exact death.
Well, I have a gun in my room. We'll shoot him. Bang. It'll be fun.
You're grounded and I ain't joking, son. Watch Frank.
Dr. Evil, do you really expect them to pay?
No, Mr. Powers. The only thing I expect them to do, I expect their asses to die. Even after they pay my ass the money, I am still going to melt every city on the planet with liquid hot magma. Release the sharks. And then, what I'm going to do, Mr. Powers, I'm going to put these sharks and laser beams attached to their heads on a beautiful Casper mattress.
Dr. Evil, you were frozen there on the extended species list.
That's my attempt at a former Ronaldo. Not a very good one.
I top rope Solicito with the shark. Oh, my God. Mamma mia.
Here,
evidently, my cycloptic colleague informs me that can't be done. Can you remind me why I pay you people?
Throw me a frickin' bone.
I always love that too, my cycloptic friends. Yeah.
Now, my cycloptic colleague.
Right. They are mutated sea bass. Ooh. Are they ill-tempered?
Are they ill-tempered? Well, that's a start.
Begin the unnecessarily slow-moving dipping mechanism. Another one that I use every time Nick and I, and you'll sometimes hear this on Hard Traveling Fanboys, every time we'll have like a, we'll do the livery and we'll split it off. Begin the unnecessarily slow-moving livery section.
Like, he's like, I'm going to assume they died. What's wrong with this? I don't get your point here.
You just don't get it.
You don't.
Oh, man.
I do that to my kids all the time.
This is a bit that was so good, and they would even top it in the second one.
Yes. Sata, bidwa, subtitle, zip it.
Would you like to have a suckle of my zipple?
When a problem comes along, you must zip it. Oh, zip it good. Actually, I put this in one of my great debate opens, and then I have a zip it in another one. A little soundbite of people
look at
arguing.
These fake fish being walked around.
First, I plan to soil myself.
To soil myself. Then I'm going to regroup and come up with a new plan. Any thoughts?
I know. I have bad teeth. We swing ourselves over the ledge. Yeah, Hugh Grant was such a schmuck.
Oh, I know. Good grief.
I love how they put them in the silver outfits at the end of all the movies.
They're quasi-futuristic outfits. Judo chop the toothpaste. Oh! That is the strongest line of floss.
Yes.
Judo trip!
And then the mutated sea bass. Like a scene out of Piranha the movie.
Yeah, I know. A rare bit of body horror here from yes. Austin Powers. Mm-hmm. And we get the one-liners in a classic Bond fashion. Not a good time to lose one's head. And at first she plays along with it. That's not the way to get ahead in life. And there's my personal favorite. No, not this one. She wasn't more headstrong. She's getting more frustrated. He'll never be the head of a major corporation.
All right, hurry back.
This is where he tries to back up the cart.
And he professes his love for Vanessa.
Yeah.
I really feel bad about that Italian bird. And he's worn her down. Won her over.
You want me to be a one-woman man, baby. Yeah.
Gotta love that view right there.
So now he's going to, yeah, this is where he tries to do the 3-point turn.
Yes, in a extremely narrow hallway. I think he does something like this in The Love Guru too. And I saw it in the trailer, I was like, why is he doing the same bit?
Right.
You know, that's one knock I have about Mike Myers. Sometimes he just goes to the well one too many times.
Sometimes it works. Like, yeah. I remember there was a bit in Goldmember that is a recycling of a joke from Wayne's World 2, but it still works because he switches it up just a little bit. That's the bit with the from Wayne's World 2. It is I think it was Kevin Pollak. They visit at the store and they're trying to get their signature or something. And he's like, I just want to make sure that we've crossed all the T's and dotted all the – and he's missing an I when he looks up.
Oh, at yeah.
And he goes, lowercase J.
Yes.
And they bring that bit back in Goldmember and it kind of works, although not as well as it did in Wayne's World 2.
Ah. But, you know, like he constantly goes to the nipple in a lot of stuff.
Yes.
He does that with Austin. He does that with Dr. Evil. He does that with Fat Bastard. Bring in the evil warhead.
Everything is phallic in this movie.
Too. Yes.
Oh, he can't get the pinky to his mouth because of the suit.
Whoop! Tight. Oh, my. Oh, it's the fembox.
This isn't really like... The costume designs are great in this, too.
Oh, hello.
You can't resist us, Austin Powers. Oh, on the contraire, you can't resist me.
Excuse me, I have to save the world. Hello. Uh-oh. Is it cold in here?
And this... A line I did not understand at that age.
Yes.
That's one of the many jokes in this movie that it took me a while to get.
Austin with his crooked glasses. That happens quite often. Arm the probe. Arming the probe!
Arming the probe!
That's the second one. This one that has the guy that's very like, he falls out of the chair. It's so stupid, but it's hysterical.
There's so many good physical gags in addition to the clever writing and everything else in these movies.
I've got to get to Dr. Evil.
Baseball, cold showers.
Margaret Thatcher naked on a cold day.
Margaret Thatcher naked on a cold day.
Of course, kids today are like, who the fuck is Margaret Thatcher?
I had no idea who Margaret Thatcher was at that age, but it was just funny.
Let's lock and load.
You can't resist us, Mr. Powers.
Oh, contra, baby.
I think you can't resist me.
Oh, my God. I remember when I touched myself came out. The vinyls.
Is that who it was? The Vinyls?
They called it The Vinyls. The Vinyls.
The Vinyls. Yeah.
I got a lot of good choices. I got this song. I got Incense and Peppermints. I got Boots Are Made for Walking. I got a lot of choices here for this our playout song at one point tonight during the show.
Secret Agent Man.
Oh, yeah.
It's a great song.
Mm-hmm. Actually kind of liked Blues Traveler's cover of it for Ace Ventura When Nature Calls.
Oh.
Yeah. I love this, and the Fembots start going wild while he's sitting there in his knickers. I've used that too sometimes. I'm like, when I'm trying to talk myself out of something, no matter what it is, I just go down to, well, you know, then, you know, their mojo, my cross modulation and smoke was coming out the jumblies, and here I am on my knickers.
They walk in on him. Yeah, this is great.
See, Ripple? All their heads are exploding. She walks by, she's like, what the fuck?
There's the one guard that likes it too.
Yes. It's not what it seems. And he's boys. Likewise. Oh.
Another joke I didn't get at the time. I broke in trying to get... All of a sudden, the Finbots came by, and smoke started to come out of the jubblies. So I thought I'd work my mojo, right? To counter their mojo. We got cross-mojinations, and the head started exploding. You know, that thing. I ended up in my knickers. That's almost like a Paul McCartney. Couldn't you hear Paul McCartney yes. saying that? You know, that whole thing. And you know, John and I, we once did this very same thing.
Yes, I was out there in my knickers.
You know, he had a cross-mulgination. We walked in there, and I said, John, what are you doing? He said, oh, you know, I'm giving the kibbles and bits, you know. And, you know, and that led to Sgt. Pepper.
Albert, you're out of the band. I don't know if you got that reference.
I love the voice, though.
There was an SNL skit. It was during the Dana Carvey, John Lovitz, Mike Myers days. Where they had this guy, there was a fifth Beatle named Albert who played like a horn. And like he was like British. He's like, I'm going to get some soup. And it was Phil Hartman. And they had to tell him he's out of the band. So like, Albert, you're out of the band.
The brilliant Phil Hartman.
Yes. Gone too soon. And here is the Secret Agent Man. That's one of those songs like that, the Mission Impossible theme. Those, I love hearing those in comedies.
Oh, they're great. Like, there's a man who leads a life of danger. Yeah, so good. Just that classic 60s guitar sound, you know?
Yeah. I love seeing the lyrics on screen. He's got to get to the big abort button.
Well, hey, if I had an evil lair, I would have to make everything very clear, because you don't want the abort button and not hit it by mistake. You want to make sure everybody knows where the abort button is.
Don't push the red button. Now you can push the red button. That was from Men in Black, which that was actually the last episode of Laughing Theater, which you've heard, hopefully you've listened to by now, with Miranda Berthold. Tie that into the new Men in Black coming out. I love this.
I want chicken. I want liver. Meow mix, please deliver.
I've actually done that to my cat.
Yo, me too. Dude, I did that to my cat all the time when I was growing up.
I did that the other day.
Yeah. It's you can't see Meow Mix at the store and not think of that. All the things you loved in the 60s, free love, swinging, parties, are all now in the 90s considered to be evil.
It's uptight squares like you. We've done things differently. His spirit would remain the same, baby. Freedom, baby, yeah.
Brace it. Freedom failed.
It's a groovy time. Nothing more pathetic than an aging
hipster, which is something I think we can all agree on.
Shut your cake hole. which he used in Sorry, Marry an Axe Murderer, but much better when he was playing his father. Shut your cake hole!
Shut your cake hole!
Oh, head, move!
Down, now!
Can I get you and clean him about?
He tries to hold Scott hostage. Go ahead, kill the little bastard.
I don't care. We just had a breakthrough. I liquidated the group, you little shit.
You little shit. I wish I was never artificially created in a lab. Scott, that hurts, Daddy, when you say that. Honestly.
There's number two with a fembot in his suitcase. No.
What?
Now, number two's at his breaking point.
Yep. I was gonna have a cover story at Forbes.
There is no world. It's just corporations. This could be a movie about Disney.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's very appreciative of how our current world is.
Yes.
Oh no, he's sobbing.
Number two should have been smart enough to know, though, sitting at that table.
Oh yes, it's a dangerous proposition.
Yes.
Oh, poor number two. Oh, Vanessa learned though the judo chop.
So there's a giant abort button now. There's a giant
self-destruct button. Yeah. Austin is such a terrible shot.
Yes, he is.
Almost a terrible shot.
And there goes Big Boy.
And this is going to be our first of the, hey, that looks like.
Yes. Which has been very funny. I don't know. Did they do it in Goldmember? Yeah, they did.
I think they did. Mm-hmm. It wasn't quite as funny in that one.
Nothing was quite as funny in that movie.
Yeah, there's some great stuff in Goldmember, though. But it's forgotten because some of the stuff that didn't work. But there's still some good stuff. Nigel and whatnot. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the kids who play Austin and Dr. Evil as youngins, they were great in that movie.
Yeah.
A little stock footage right there.
Bad Bastard's great in that movie too.
Surprise, surprise.
And my neck, those kinda look like a vagina.
I went on the Subway diet. It worked with Janet. I love you, Mrs. Powers. It's a nice rock Vanessa's got on now.
Yeah. And he's got his teeth fixed, or his fixed teeth, as I was about to say.
And we got another one of the clever placement of objects.
Yes. Oh, poor Basil. Look at that view.
Yes. Oh, God. Oh, to be on set that day.
Yeah. Honeydews.
I love it. Nice rack. That's another one I use. He gave us a strong. It's bizarre.
Disappeared from my track.
Ah.
Oh, coffee.
By the way, you've been made a full agent. Really? Thanks. Wow, who doesn't FaceTime with their boss naked?
Who doesn't?
I love how the milk
is. That's the only way we do meetings around here. We a little backwoods in that kind of way.
Very,
The balloon gag is great, So incredibly sexy.
I knew I had to have you.
Put it then and there.
Actually, I couldn't stop staring at your teeth. Did you let it go?
And here is random task.
Coming up another line. Use a lot.
Who throws his shoe?
Honestly.
That really hurt.
I'm going to have a lump there.
Shoe. Honest.
Fight like a woman.
Woman. Judo.
Nope, not quite. Thank God they held on to the penis enlarger pump.
Austin, use the enlarger pump. It's not mine.
You know, Vanessa knew the judo chop. She could have used it on a random task.
That's very true. She could have just helped.
Well, she does with the champagne.
How do those things even... Well... That's perhaps a story for another. I want you to go on Talking Pop to talk that
one. Yeah.
None of those things work, exactly.
Oh, Jenny would really want to know. Looks like Uranus.
That looks like Uranus.
Well, you know.
Well, you know.
It's two episodes of Laughing Theater alone with a Uranus joke.
Hey, you can never have too many Uranus jokes. Good God.
I'll get you, Austin Powers.
It's frickin' freezing in here, Mr. Bigglesworth.
Oh, yeah. And there you have it. Austin Powers, he's the man for
freeze you. Bow, 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 bow. Awesome.
What a classic.
Oh, so much fun. I haven't watched this all the way through in a while, so I thank you for handling.
This is a movie that I know like the back of my hand. It's one of my favorite movies of all time.
Now, there's this little thing where we just get to see a lot of sexy Liz Hurley photos with the, you know, the little red dress. Mm-hmm. There she is with kind of an afro. Kind of a... No, no, yes, no! And I'm spent. This guy, who's this, John Cryer?
looks like him.
Looks like Ducky.
Ducky. Yes. Yeah, Ducky, yeah. He's actually playing Lex Luthor on Supergirl now.
Yeah. Hey, you know, what'd you think of Jesse Eisenberg's Lex Luthor?
Oh, God, I hated it.
Yeah?
My least favorite, one of my least favorite takes on a character in a comic book movie.
Wow.
I hated it so much. It just seemed like a bad fit from the get-go.
Mm-hmm.
And then you watch it, and he's, like, feeding a sucker to a guy. And, like, I'm like, that's, like, none of this is Lex. This is, like, maybe the Joker would do that, but not Lex.
Now, nobody, after you watch Smallville, you're just like, oh, Michael Rosenbaum.
Right, Rosenbaum. And even, like, John Shea, the guy that played Lex on Lois and Clark back in the 90s, was really good.
And Gene Hackman, yeah. Too.
Yeah, but Rosenbaum really redefined that character in a lot of ways, so.
Wouldn't mind being caught in the rain with Liz Hurley in that outfit.
Oh, Lord, I know. I don't remember this outfit. She's photographing him now. And no, there's the John Cryer guy.
Oh, God. He's even him's like, oh, shit. He's like, what the fuck? Basically topless with short shorts and go-go boots. And he's spent. Mike's like, I'll be back in a minute.
Swing, baby, yeah.
I love that.
The impish smile. And here we get the BBC song.
Yeah, that's, and that,
Let me see. Is it my love to me.
Is Susanna Hoffs playing in this?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, because her husband is Jay Roach.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. BBC One, BBC Two,
BBC Three, BBC Four, BBC Five.
The Goldie Hawn looking girl.
BBC Seven, BBC Heaven.
Ah, oh, such a great one.
Will ya?
Make me tea.
Make me tea.
On the telly.
My love to me. Put on the telly.
That was the costume, the Halloween costume I wore was that Austin outfit. And it was, really? it was like so thin, and it was a cold Halloween that year. So my twig and berries were up the tree. It was fucking cold. I don't know what was worse, that or my Ace Ventura costume.
Now, was that Susanna Hoffs or was that Vanessa Kensington playing Susanna Hoffs?
No, that's Susanna Hoffs right there.
Yeah, it is. Oh, Lord. She was angelic as well.
Yes, back in the day.
What a talent.
Mm-hmm.
She's just on drums.
You got me.
Dude.
Some dude.
You keep saying you got something for me.
You know, Mike Myers is something of a musician as well. He's not like a accomplished or anything, but he can play a little bit.
Yeah.
You
I mean, he did all those riffs on Wayne's World skits himself.
Yeah. And Carvey's a hell of a drummer.
Yeah, he actually is. Did you watch that Dana Carvey show? What was it? It was like where they had people battling each other, impressions.
Oh, yes. I did, because, you know, as an amateur voice guy, I was thinking, I'll watch that. I did watch it. It wasn't as good as I kind of hoped it was, but it had some moments. It was pretty funny at times, I thought.
Yeah.
He's just a really funny guy. I mean, both of them are, but Dana's like, Mike Myers, I think, is funnier from a, you know, writing perspective and from a, you know, a movie or a TV show or something like that. Dana is funnier just off the cuff.
Yeah.
Like, just in an interview, in stand-up, whatever. He's just like it's a different style of comedy. He's just so quick with that stuff.
So like the age you were when Austin Powers came out, that was pretty much the age I was when, like, Church Chat, all that stuff was just starting on SNL. Mm-hmm. So I remember doing, like, sophomore year of high school, I remember doing it for a history class. I had to do a project, and I did a Saturday Night Live with all historical sketches.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember doing, we had a Church Chat, we had a Hans and Franz sketch, we did a Cheers parody. It was quite bad. I think I have it on VHS somewhere. It's very bad. It's very bad. Oh, my God. Well, that was a lot of fun, Greg. You know, seeing Austin Powers, international man of mystery. So before we go, what's coming up? We talked about it a little bit earlier, but you got anything else you want to plug with HTF or Talking WCW or What If or anything else you got going on?
No, I think up next on WCW is War Games, HTF. We got X-Men month all month long, leading into Spider-Man month next month. And What If Wrestling, we haven't recorded any recently. We'll see about possibly getting a batch of that, but no promises. And other than that, nah, nothing much. I'm hanging around on Twitter. If people want to hit me up, I am GPhillips8652 on Twitter. And happy to follow you back if you follow me.
Awesome. Yeah. For myself, I have another episode of Great Debate coming soon. I don't know, this will probably be up first, but so far I have confirmed I have Nick Duke and Scott Criscolo, still working on the third guest, so we'll see what happens there. Have more episodes of Laugh and Theater to come, with possibly Mr. Andrew Reich, Mr. J. Arsenio D'Amato, and J.T. Rosero are probably be some of the next guests I will have. We'll reveal those movies at the time, but let's see. For Justin, Justin went a little away from what you think you would do. Andrew Reich, probably one of my favorite movies from when I was about 13, 14 years old. And Mr. D'Amato, it's basically a biography of his. So those are some little hints. So I don't know if you guys can figure that out, but, you know, that's what I'm giving you. Also, Year and Pop will be back, being in July. We're going to be doing the year 1976. So Rocky will be a big topic of discussion that day. And then, you know, we're all looking forward to 77, which is Star Wars, amongst other things. So go to playthroughnews.com, check out all the articles, participate in the greatest WWE televised match project, listen to all of our great podcasts on both feeds, the PTBN Pop feed and the PTBN Wrestling feed. So I want to say thank you again to Mr. Greg Phillips for being in the theater tonight. Greg?
My pleasure.
Awesome. So, I am Andy Atherton, and thank you for joining us here at Laughing Theater. But for now, the theater is closed, and we'll see you at the next showing. Take care, everybody.
Consideration paid for by the following. Place to Be Nation's JT Rosero and Chad Campbell here. We want to let you know that we have over 24 podcasts available on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and PlaceToBeNation.com. We now offer them to you on two great feeds. On the Place to Be Nation wrestling feed, we dive into topics running the gamut from today's WWE to the glory days of yesteryear and the ins and outs of the territory days. In addition to our full-length shows, we also deliver to you special pod blasts on topics old and new.
The Place to Be Nation pop feed is a veritable treasure trove of great content. Offer tremendous shows covering the land of movies, television, life, comics, and sports, brought to you by the most knowledgeable and insightful folks in the podcast world.
You can find all these current shows, plus archives of our previous podcasts over the past 8 years as well, by subscribing to our feeds on iTunes. And while there, be sure to rate and leave feedback as well. All of these shows, plus others, available at PlaceToBeNation.com, where we cover pro wrestling, sports, movies, comics, plus in-depth stretch projects and more. Be sure to support our site by using www.PlaceToBeNation.com/Amazon while doing your online shopping. And be sure to join us at our forum at Bigelow34.proboards.com. For all sorts of wrestling, sports, and pop culture discussion each and every day, where you can make your voice heard. We also want to thank our friends at Boneheads Wing Bar, ProWrestlingOnly.com, and TheHistoryOfWrestling.com. Be sure to follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr as well. PlaceToBeNation.com, the only place to be in your pop culture world.